Good afternoon. So today we are going to be discussing decision theory, and the aspects we will be covering under decision theory is to talk about the meaning of decision theory, the process of problem analysis, and then we'll look at decision situations. First, let me advise you that for every video that you may want to watch, it is better that you first of all download the video so that you'll be able to zoom and see the board clearly. If you watch the video directly on YouTube, you may not be able to see the tiny characters, but if you download, you'll be able to zoom and see the videos clearer. To the meaning of decision, a decision is a choosing course of action. When you make a choice to take a certain action, that will mean that you have taken a decision. So a decision is a choosing course of action in order to achieve a certain or a stated objective. A decision is a choosing course of action in order to achieve an objective. An objective is a desired state of satisfaction. We set objective so that when we attain that objective, we have a sense of satisfaction. So that objective is what motivates, is the motivation for taking action. Now the process of problem analysis is to first of all identify a gap or identify a situation that needs a decision to be made. You must first of all identify that you are in a situation which needs a decision to be made. When that gap or when that decision situation is identified, the next thing is to analyze that decision situation. When you analyze the decision situation, you are able to come out with model formulation and then generate feasible solutions. When the feasible solutions are generated, you then choose a course of action. In the process of analyzing a problem, we need to identify a gap or a need, something that needs to be satisfied. You need to identify a gap or a need that needs to be met or satisfied. And this can be done by careful observation. There are always two types of variables that are involved in the analysis state. There is the dependent or the controlled or the controllable variable. The dependent or the controlled or the controllable variable are the variables that can be manipulated. They can be manipulated. The second type of variable are the independent variable. Those ones cannot be manipulated. There are two steps that are involved in the process of analyzing the decision situation. The first step is to validate the objective that is to be met. The first step is to validate the objective that is to be met. This process of validating the objective is important because that is what gives meaning to the whole exercise. If the objective cannot be validated, then the decision-making process is just like a waste, or it's just like an exercise in futility. The second step in the analysis of the problem situation is to be able to identify the items or the variables that make up the decision process. When the second step has been observed, where you identify the variables that are involved in the decision situation, we then move on to the specification of model. In the model specification aspect, the interaction of the variable with each other is first of all studied and identified so that a model is now developed to represent the decision situation. A model will then be developed to represent the decision situation. This model specification helps us to better understand the interaction or the relevance of each variable in the decision situation and how they interact with each other. This model specification helps us to better understand the relevance of each variable in the decision situation. It also helps us to manipulate the variable in order to achieve the desired outcome. It also helps us to manipulate the variables so that we can achieve the desired outcome. Another advantage of model specification is that it helps us to generate feasible courses of action. Once the nature and the interaction of the variables with each other has been understood, then the decision maker can go ahead to generate a feasible course of action. Once the interaction or the nature of the variables and their interaction with each other has been understood through the model formulation, the decision maker can then go ahead to generate feasible courses of action. We shall now go a little bit deeper into the topic decision theory by considering the decision-making situations. We shall consider the decision-making situations, and our focus shall be on situation of risk and uncertainty. Our focus shall be on the situation of risk and uncertainty. Under the situation of uncertainty, we shall consider the method of Laplace, world, which is the maximum minimum solution. Then we shall consider the maximum solution, and then the regret or the minimum maximum situation. A risk is the possibility of an unfortunate occurrence. The decision maker under the situation of risk has an idea or knows the outcome that will come if the situation arises. The decision maker knows has an idea of the outcome if the situation arising. So therefore, he can attach probability to the possibility of the outcome. Probability is the chance or likelihood of an event occurring. Probability is the chance or likelihood of the occurrence of an event, and it is usually measured from between 0 and 1. It is usually measured from between 0 and 1. 0 means that the event will not occur. 0 means certainty of the event not occurring. While 1 means certainty of the event occurring. So probability is usually between 0.1 to 0.9. Once you cross to one whole number, it means that you are certain of the occurrence of the event. And then once the outcome is 0, it means that you are certain that the event will not occur. The total of all probabilities under any situation must sum up to 1. The total of all probabilities under any situation must sum up to 1. For example, a probability of 0.4 simply means that the event has a chance of occurring four times out of 10. The probability of 0.4, for instance, means that the event has the chance of occurring 4 times out of 10. The probability of 0.6, for example, means that the event has a chance of occurring 6 times out of 10. Probability can either be objective or subjective. Probability can either be objective or subjective. If the probability can be determined scientifically or mathematically, then it is objective. For instance, if you toss a coin, you know that a coin has two sides, head and tail. If you toss a coin, the coin lands, it is either it lands with head or it lands with tail. Or if you throw a die, you know that a die has six sides. So the probability that you will get six is 1/6, because a die has only one face. Out of the six faces, a die has only one face that carries figure 6. So the probability that can be determined mathematically or scientifically are called objective probabilities. While the probabilities that cannot be determined mathematically are called subjective probabilities. subjective probability usually covers most business decisions because there is nobody that will toss a coin or throw a die to take business decisions. If business decisions are going to be taken, they are most times taken based on subjective probabilities, in the sense that it will require the technical know-how, the expertise, the experience of the individual taking the decision to be able to assign probability to whatever decision, situation he or she wants to make. This situation of business decision are usually called subjective probability simply because no two individuals can assign the same probability to the same situations. If two people are picked and asked to randomly assign probability, either based on their educational level or based on their experience or based on their technical know-how, no two people can assign the same probability to the same situation. So this is why subjective probability are usually assigned to business decision. We shall now consider an example under the situation of risk, an example of decision taking under the situation of risk, where we have an investor who wishes to set to put $100,000 in an investment or in three different investment opportunities called A, B, and C, under three states of nature called normal, boom, and recession. Probability have been determined for two out of the three states of nature, which is boom and recession. When there is boom, the probability of returns is 0.5, and when there is recession, probability of returns 0.2. During the boom, income has been determined to be 16,000, while income for A, B, and C has been determined to be 16,000, 14,000, and 10,000, and the same thing for under the normal and recession. So we shall now analyze this situation to see how the decision will be taken under situation of risk. Now we have converted the information in the example into a table where we have the probability for the this represent the state of nature, while this represent the opportunities A, B, and C. The probability when the economy is in boom is 0.5, and the probability when the economy is in recession is 0.2. We are not giving the probability when the economy is normal, but we know that the sum of all probabilities must be equal to 1. So if we add these two to get 0.7 and subtract from 1, so probability for normal is 1 minus probability of boom plus probability of recession. That's 1 minus 0.5 plus 0.2. That gives us 1 minus 0.7, which is 0.3. So we have probability of normal to be 0.3. Our probability of normal to be 0.3. Having gotten that, we now know that under the situation of boom, from the example, the income for opportunity A is 16,000, for opportunity B is 14,000, for opportunity C is 10,000. And then under normal, the income for opportunity A is 10,000, B is 12,000, and C is 8,000. While under recession, the income for A is 5,000, B is 4,000, and C is 3,000, as we have been given in the example. So what we need to determine now is the expected returns, which will be probability multiplied by the returns. For opportunity A, the expected return for A will be 16,000 multiplied by the probability of 0.5 plus 10,000 multiplied by probability of 0.3 plus 5,000 multiplied by probability of 0.2, while for opportunity B, the expected returns will be 14,000 multiplied by 0.5 plus 12,000 multiplied by 0.3 plus 4,000 multiplied by 0.2. While for opportunity C, we have 10,000 multiplied by 0.5 plus 8,000 multiplied by 0.3 plus 3,000 multiplied by 0.2. We have now determined the expected returns for opportunity A to be 12,000, expected return for opportunity B to be 11,400, and the expected return for opportunity C to be 8,000. Under this decision-making situation of risk, the decision maker is expected to choose the best option, which is opportunity A, which gives the highest expected return of 12,000. Under the condition of uncertainty, the decision maker does not have enough information to be able to allocate probability to the expected outcomes. The decision maker does not have enough information to be able to allocate probabilities to the expected outcome. So we have different ways of dealing with this situation, the first being the Laplace. Under the Laplace solution, of decision under uncertainty situation, since the Professor Laplace came up with the idea that since the decision maker does not have enough information to be able to assign probability to the expected outcomes, what the decision maker is expected to do is to consider all these expected outcomes to be of equal likelihood. Therefore, we apply equal likelihood of occurrence to them. For example, in the last solution that we did, when we have A, B, and C opportunities, boom, and recession. Under the Laplace solution, since we do not have enough information to be able to allocate probability to each of the states of nature, what it is suggested to be done is to allocate equal likelihood of occurrence. So since we have three different states of nature, we will then allocate 1/3 to each of them, since we have three, so that the expected returns for opportunity A, for instance, would be 1/3 of 16,000, will be 1/3 of 16,000 plus 1/3 of 10,000 plus 1/3 of 5,000. So under the Laplace, we have divided them equally into 1/3, since we have three states of nature, and then finding the expected returns for opportunity A gives us 10,333, for opportunity B gives us 10,000, and opportunity C gives us 7,000. So under this situation, decision maker under situation of uncertainty, we still choose opportunity A with the highest expected return of 10,333. Another method of dealing with uncertainty under decision theory is what was propounded by WALD, which is called WALD, W-A-L-D, WALD criterion, which is called the Maxi Mean criterion. It suggested that the decision maker should take the minimum returns, of all opportunities, and then pick the maximum of the minimum. So say you take the maximum of the minimum. So the first thing for us to do is to pick the minimum. is to pick the minimum return for opportunity A. The minimum return is 5,000, while for opportunity B, the minimum return is 4,000, and then for opportunity C, the minimum return is 3,000. Now we have picked the minimum returns of the three opportunities, which are 5,000, 4,000, and 3,000 for A, B, and C respectively. So out of these three minimum returns, we will now pick the maximum of the minimum, the maximum of the minimum, which is 5,000. That is what the world or the maxi minimum criterion method of taking decision under uncertainty is all about. A third method of dealing with uncertainty in decision theory is what we call the maxi-max, the maxi-max method, the maxi-max method. As the name suggests, in this method, the decision maker will pick the maximum of the maximum returns for each opportunity. The decision maker will pick the maximum, which is the highest of the highest. Another way to translate this is saying picking the highest of the highest. So we first of all look for the highest returns of each opportunity. We look for the highest returns of each opportunity. For opportunity A, the highest return is 16,000. For opportunity B, the highest return is 14,000. And for opportunity C, the highest return is 10,000. Therefore, now we have determined the maximum of all the three opportunities. We will now pick the maximum of the maximum, which still stands as 16,000. Therefore, the decision maker will pick the maximum. This is the column for the maximum returns for each of the opportunities. So the decision maker will then go ahead to pick the maximum of the maximum, which happens to be 16,000. The last of the method of dealing with uncertainty is what is called the regret or the Savage method, because it was developed by Professor Savage. It is called the regret criterion. In this, what we shall do in the regret criterion method is that for every column, for every of the state of nature, we shall pick the highest value and subtract. We shall pick the highest value and subtract all the figures from the highest value. Boom, normal, and recession. For this column, for this boom column, the highest value happens to be 16. So we shall pick this highest value and subtract. For the first column, I shall subtract the highest value, which is 16. I shall then subtract 16,000 minus 16,000. That gives me zero. Then here I will have 16,000 minus 14,000. 16,000 minus 14,000, that gives me 2,000. And here I have 16,000 minus 10,000, gives me 6,000. I come to the second column and pick the highest value, which happens to be 12,000. So here for this column, for this box, I have 12,000 minus 10,000. That gives me 2,000. Here I have 12,000 minus 12,000. That gives me zero. And here I have 12,000 minus 8,000. That gives me 4,000. For the third column, I pick the highest, which is 5,000. So here I have 5,000 minus 5,000. That gives me zero. That gives me zero. 5,000 minus 4,000. That gives me 1,000. And then here I have 5,000 minus 3,000. That gives me 2,000. By this, I have calculated my regret. By this I have calculated my regret. So the next thing I will then do. So the next thing I will then do is to find the maximum of this regret. To find the maximum of this regret. For this first rule, the maximum is 2,000. For this second rule, the maximum is also 2,000. For this third rule, the maximum is 6,000. Having determined the maximum of the regret calculations, I will then pick the minimum out of this maximum. I will pick the minimum, but in this case, I have two minimums. I have two minimums, so I can pick any of these two. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoy watching.